Advent Pharma welcomes you to the ocean of practical knowledge about small animal practice, that is, Hadwell's YouTube channel. We are thankful to Dr. Vinod Kumar for sharing his practical tips with fellow veterinarians.
It is a very important topic. As far as we the practitioners or regular practitioners are concerned, it's a very, very important clinical sign. Weight loss happens in dogs as well as weight gain happens in dogs and cats. So the client may be complaining that, see, it is losing weight daily. To find out the reason is a Herculean task sometimes. The cat may be losing weight like anything. We say cachexia, emaciation, like that. So we have to find out, because losing weight means it is losing all the nutrients or the substances from solid substances from the body. So that after a certain period of time, it will be slowly going to the death. Death happens. So we have to find out what the cause of weight loss is. Another thing is weight gain. Weight gain is not a simple thing. We have to find out the cause of weight gain. And we have to adjust the cause or deal with the cause for controlling the weight gain. The same problem occurs in human beings. Now we will go deep into, first of all, weight loss. So, what is weight loss? Loss of weight. So, weight loss suddenly occurs. So what I do in my clinic is, whenever a patient is presented with vomiting and diarrhea, see, I have a data. It's every week or every 2 weeks they will be coming with their pets. I will be taking their body weight. I have the data with me. My St. Bernard pup, day before yesterday it came for vaccination. Okay, it was having 8 kilograms body weight. Now suddenly, yesterday evening, it started vomiting and diarrhea, gastroenteritis, maybe a food generated one. And now due to severe vomiting and diarrhea, there will be, we studied fluid therapy. We know lot of fluids will be lost with electrolytes. The muscle mass is full of the body, the somatic cells, the somatic tissue, everything is full of water. The body water itself is 60%. So when the water is lost, naturally body weight will be drained down. So this decreases the weight loss. So by vomiting and diarrhea, there will be sudden decrease of the weight loss. That can be recouped very quickly. Give some IV fluids, oral fluids, or whatever it be. We have mentioned in all those fluid therapy classes. We can recoup it, we can compensate it, and we can save the animal from dying, from dangers. But here the weight loss means a progressive weight loss due to some other pathological factors, some other factors, not only pathological, some other factors which we have to diagnose. We are going to diagnose each and each. Certain things only. No, I am not going deep into the textbooks. So everything is being given in the textbooks, but I am not going deep into everything. I am going to give you an account of the commonest causes only. The commonest. That is all that we want. Weight loss. We will see that there is a progressive weight loss or a weight loss in a dog or a cat when there is 10% decrease in body weight. So 10% reduction in body weight is there. So client says that he was having 20 kilograms body weight last week. There is no vomiting, there is no diarrhea, nothing at all. But now it is only 16 kgs. It is an 8-month-old German Shepherd. What can we say? Within a week time, it lost 4 kilograms. Is it a weight loss? Definitely, it's a weight loss. It has lost 20% of the body weight in 1 week time. That is weight loss. If more than 10% weight is lost, then it is a weight loss. It is significant weight loss, which we have to intervene. If, as I said, if there is a rapid change in weight loss, yesterday it was 20 kilograms, today it is 18 kilograms. Okay, that, and the dog is having vomiting and diarrhea. Of course, that is a different thing. That weight loss is due to changes in the body water. That we already told. So, when we are dealing with the weight loss, we have to study about two main things. This is so simple. Simply, you keep in mind two things. One is the resting energy requirement, and the other is the maintenance energy requirement. The resting energy requirement and maintenance energy requirement. The resting energy requirement means the requirement in the animal which is in a physically stable, neutral position. That means when it is sleeping, it is under complete rest. The requirement of energy in that condition is known as the resting energy requirement. That is, truly speaking, the energy requirement when the animal is sleeping. Always the energy requirement of the animal or the human being is calculated in kilocalories per day. You know, calories, it is a unit of energy. Calorie, joules, etc. Calorie is a unit of energy. 1 kilocalorie is 1000 calories. So, resting energy, energy requirement is always calculated in kilocalories per day. And the resting energy requirement can be calculated as, so that is a resting energy requirement. Then second is the maintenance energy requirement. So now it was sleeping. Okay, it was sleeping. Fine, it is sleeping. It was sleeping. Now it woke up. Woke up, it again became alert. Now it is running, walking, barking, and active all the time. And so general activities like running, walking, barking, eating, respiring, everything, gasping, panting, etc., all these things, the general activities of the animal. And during this general activities, energy requirement is there. This energy requirement is known as the daily maintenance energy requirement. So we have the resting energy requirement and the maintenance energy requirement. Together makes the total energy requirement. Generally, okay, I think you got the point. The resting energy requirement, the maintenance energy requirement. So when we were studying fluid therapy, we mentioned about the water balances. We have the total fluid requirement. We have the maintenance fluid requirement. We have the fluid deficits or the fluid loss. Like that, here also we have the resting energy requirement and the maintenance energy requirement. Resting energy requirement means when it is absolutely at rest, that is sleeping. The energy requirement when it is sleeping. And the maintenance energy requirement means it has woken up and it is moderately or generally active. Not strenuous works, I mean. Okay, that is maintenance energy requirement. Generally in a dog, maintenance energy requirement is twice the resting energy requirement. That is a general formula to calculate it. Let us keep this in mind. If the maintenance, the resting energy requirement in a dog is 1 kilocalorie, the maintenance energy requirement for this dog is 2 kilocalories. That is twice the resting energy requirement. Likewise in the cat. Cat, when it is sleeping, it has a resting energy requirement. When it is awakened, it has a maintenance energy requirement per day. So, the maintenance energy requirement in the cat is generally 1.4 times than the resting energy requirement. That means, in the cat, if the resting energy requirement is 1 kilocalorie per day, the maintenance energy requirement in that cat is 1.4 kilocalories for that particular cat. So, that is regarding RER, the resting energy requirement and maintenance energy requirement. But the resting energy requirement has to be calculated. Then only we can calculate the maintenance energy requirement. The resting energy requirement can be calculated by this formula. That is, the resting energy requirement in kilocalories per day is equal to 70 plus 30 into body weight. W is the body weight. 70 plus 30 into the body weight in dogs. And 50 into body weight in cats. This is very important. You please note it down, or also I'll be giving this PowerPoint presentation also. So, resting energy requirement in a dog is 70 plus 30 into body weight in kilograms. Body weight in kilograms. Suppose a dog is 20 kilograms. What will be the resting energy requirement for that dog? 70 plus 30 into 20. 30 into 20 is 600. Okay? Plus 70. Plus 70, 670. So 670 kilocalories per day is the resting energy requirement. So what should be the maintenance energy requirement? Twice the resting energy requirement. That is 670 into 2. That is 1340. 1340. So 1340 is the maintenance energy requirement for the dog. So what should be the total energy requirement per day? Like the resting plus maintenance. 670 plus 1340. That much is the, that much kilocalories. What is it? 670 plus, I will calculate it. 670 plus 10 is the total energy requirement. 2010 kilocalories is the total energy requirement for that 20 kilogram weighing dog per day. Okay, got it. So another formula is also there to find out the MER. MER is equal to 110 into body weight raised to 0.75 for dogs and 70 into weight for indoor cats and 80 into W body weight for active outdoor cats. You will leave all these things. Just remember this. The resting energy requirement is 70 plus 30 into body weight in kilograms in the dog and 50 into body weight in kilograms in the cat. And the maintenance energy requirement is 2 times the resting energy requirement in the dog and 1.4 times the resting energy requirement in the cat. And both these together makes the total energy requirement. So whenever it is undergoing emaciation or cachexia or weight loss, we have to calculate this energy, total energy requirement we have to supply this energy in kilocalories. That is our goal. Otherwise, we will lose the patient. Such a progressively weight-loss animal, if you are simply giving intravenous fluid therapy only, it will not survive. It needs food nutrients like fat, protein, carbohydrates, bulk, such as the fibers, vitamins, microelements, minerals, everything they need. We have to supply all these things. Okay, that is what we are going to study. Whenever there is weight loss, there will be total depletion of body nitrogen. That is lean body mass, the muscle mass of the animal will be burnt. That is why it will become very, it is becoming thin. Muscle mass and fat will be burnt off. Such as in some hypermetabolic conditions. Hypermetabolic condition means whenever the metabolic rate is increased. When the metabolic rate is increased, in certain periods of time, like trauma. Of course, you know, when there is a severe trauma, there is a motor vehicle accident. It has fractured, severe trauma, soft tissue traumas, fracture of the mandible, fracture of the long bones, fracture of the ribs. Then a lot of wounds are there, penetrating wounds, open wounds, incised wounds, contusions are there. So a lot of trauma are there. For repairing this, the cells need a lot of nutrition. Cells need a lot of energy. For supplying energy, all the other somatic cells will be hypermetabolized. The metabolic rate will be increased. And so the need of energy is also increased. That is why in such animals, we have to feed more nutritious food. Okay. Trauma, diseases. To fight against the disease, the immune system has to work more. Immune system, the T cells, the B cells, etc. Then the chemical mediators, all needs a lot of energy. The energy is met with the food which is intaken. Then stress. Lot of stress is there. Due to stress, to overcome the stress, all the cells will be in a hypermetabolic pathway where the need of energy is more. Burns. In burns, plasma is lost. Need of energy is more. Neoplasia. In extensive neoplasia, there is faster multiplying cells. They need more energy. So the requirement of energy is more. They need to eat more. But if they are not eating more, there is a negative energy balance. There is a negative energy balance. So that the animal will undergo thinning. Thinning, that we say as weight loss. All the body muscles will be burnt off or the fat will be burnt off in need of energy. We used to use two technical terms like emaciation and cachexia. Emaciation means thinning or weight loss by prolonged malnutrition or undernutrition. That is emaciation. Whereas cachexia means it's a general physical wasting and malnutrition associated with two conditions. Number one is cancer neoplasia, that is cancer cachexia. Number two is due to congestive heart failure, that is cardiac cachexia. So cachexia and emaciation are different. Emaciation means it is due to absolute malnutrition. It is not able to eat anything. Either you are not offering anything or it is not able to eat anything. On the other hand, cachexia means eating and drinking is fine, but due to the pathological factors, due to cancer, the need of energy is more. But it is eating, the eating food is insufficient to provide the requirement of energy. So, in that is cancer cachexia. Cardiac cachexia means these are cachexia. Cardiac cachexia is occurring due to congestive heart failure. In congestive heart failure, the heart is unable to pump the nutrified blood to the tissues. And so, wasting occurs. Whenever cancer cachexia and cardiac cachexia is seen, don't give a good prognosis. Don't give a hope to the client, because if the cancer is associated with cachexia and if the CHF is associated with the cachexia, it gives a bad prognosis. Okay, gives a bad prognosis. See the cachexia. It needs a thorough clinical examination by all means to find out the cause of this wasting or to find out the cause of this weight loss. It's a Herculean task. And now we are going to one important topic, that is the causes of weight loss. It can be due to inadequate intake of nutrients. Either inadequate intake or extensive drainage. So, inadequate intake of nutrients can be due to primary causes and secondary causes. Increased nutrient requirement due to pathological factors. It is eating well, but that itself is not sufficient due to some pathological factors. Maybe it can be due to reduced nutrient assimilation. See, I am coming deep detail into it. Reduced nutrient assimilation, increased nutrient metabolism or synthesis, increased nutrient loss. Let us take the first one, inadequate intake of nutrients. The primary causes and secondary causes are there. The primary causes means poor quality diet. See, the client may be telling that, mostly the client tells that they are giving this, they are absolutely dissatisfied. They are giving this, they are giving that, they give one egg a day because somebody, some human doctor told that, no, don't give any more egg because egg will increase your cholesterol, increase the cholesterol of your dog, and so that heart attack will come to your dog and it may die at any time. Sometimes some bloody fool, this breeder also might have said this. Heart attack stories. What we tell, there is no such heart attack in the dog. If the egg is consumed by the dog, nothing will happen. You give 10 or 15 eggs a day, nothing will happen to your dog. There is no such dietary hypercholesterolemia in the dog. No, it will not happen. This is species differentiated. We, the human species, contract this disease due to our sedentary lifestyle. It is a lifestyle disease. Simply not doing any exercise and eating 10 eggs a day, definitely he will die of atherosclerosis. It is not the thing in dog. Dogs always do their exercises. Dogs will not ride a bicycle. Dogs will not ride a motorbike. Whenever they want to go out, they will not take the car for going out. They will walk and run and go only. So all those excess nutrients in their body will be burnt off. This is a general scenario in the dog. But in the cat, it is entirely different. In the cat, generally stray cats and our ordinary mongrel cats, they are highly active. They eat from our house, immediately jump the wall, they go out, they roam around, they fight with other cats, and they sometimes come back in the evening with lot of wounds on the body. So with this roaming, jumping, running and fighting, this all these excess nutrients will be burnt off.
Hatred Pharma launches Hatclav 250 syrup and Hatclav 500 tablets. Amoxicillin and clovenic acid in the ratio 4:1, which is required for our pets. Hatclav, potentiated amino penicillin systemic drug. Amoxicillin plus potassium clovenate. Bactericidal amino penicillin with beta lactamase inhibitor with extended spectrum of antibacterial activity. Amoxicillin and potassium clovenate oral suspension, Hatclav 250 suspension. Amoxicillin 200 mg plus potassium clovenate 50 mg per 5 ml. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic for bacterial infections, skin, soft tissue and UTI infections. Dosage for dogs: 13.75 mg per kg every 12 hours. For cats: 62.5 mg per cat every 12 hours. Route: oral. Presentation: 30 ml. Amoxicillin and potassium clovenate tablets, Hatclav 500 tablets. Amoxicillin 400 mg plus potassium clovenate 100 mg. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic for bacterial infections, skin, soft tissue and UTI infections. Dosage for dogs: 13.75 mg per kg every 12 hours. For cats: 62.5 mg per cat every 12 hours. Route: oral. Presentation: 1:10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatred.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
It will not be deposited. And so, we can say that it is a lifestyle disease in the human beings, unlike in the animals. So, sometimes the client used to offer the dog highly nutritious diet. But since out of love to his dog, his pet, he may not be satisfied. Then he generally comes to us and he will tell, "Doctor, I am giving this thing, one egg a day, two breads a day. I am afraid to give all these things, but still I am unsatisfied. What to give more?" So in such cases, we have to take the body weight. We have to calculate the MER. We have to calculate the BER. So the resting energy requirement, the maintenance energy requirement, add these together, and then we have to calculate the total energy requirement in that animal. Then we have to take each nutrients. Beef contains this much of kilocalories, chicken contains this much, this vegetable contains this much, this vegetable contains this much, bread contains this much, so egg contains this much. So according to that, we have to calculate the total energy requirement, the total amount of food to be offered. This is a scientific way. This is what we should generally do, or we are generally doing in our clinic. What I am doing is that. So sometimes the dog may be offered a poor quality diet. That makes the primary cause for inadequate intake of nutrients. Sometimes the food may be nutritionally acceptable. It will be highly palatable. But inadequate amounts to the normal animal. It is highly palatable, but only little bit of being fed. I have seen that in growing pups, it is a Great Dane pup, 4 months old, very fast growing Great Dane pup. The client is giving only 10 pellets of puppy diet, Pedigree or Royal Canin, only 10 pellets. He is afraid to give more. I said, what are you doing? With this 10 pellets, what, how he can go forward? Then again, considering the age, we are taking the body weight, calculating the RER, calculating the MER, adding these together, taking the complete energy requirement. According to that, the food has to be designed. Okay. Then, the third primary cause is, it's a nutritionally acceptable diet in inadequate amounts for different stages of life like pregnancy, lactation, growth, strenuous exercise, cold, heat, etc. The client is unaware of it. See, the male dogs, they have only less number of different stages. But the female bitches, they have significant different stages of life, like pregnancy. In this time, the energy requirement is more, double. Lactation, again, 3 times. Lactation is the period where the energy requirement is at the peak. The most important period or stage of life where it needs the maximum calorie food. Lactation. Then growth. During the growth phase, especially in fast growing dogs, we can imagine what is the growth rate of a miniature pincher, growth rate of a chihuahua, growth rate of a pug, growth rate of a Yorkshire Terrier, and versus the growth rate of a Doberman, growth rate of a Rottweiler, growth rate of a Saint Bernard, growth rate of a Great Dane, growth rate of a Dalmatian, growth rate of a Labrador, a German Shepherd. They are all fast growing dogs. You can imagine the size between a 3 month old Chihuahua and a 3 month old Great Dane. So that difference is there. So everything should be calculated according to the body weight. So growth is an important factor where we should feed adequate nutrients. Strenuous exercises. What strenuous exercise? What are we going to use the dog to pull the cart in our country? No, they are not pulling the cart. But certain exercises, strenuous exercises are there. Like in athletic dogs, Salukis, Great Danes, Greyhounds, other sporting dogs. They are used for sporting. Generally, their metabolic rate will be very high. For such dogs, we have to keep the threshold high. We need extremes of cold. When I went to a very, very cold climate, it was in Northeast. My friend said, we have to eat meat all the time here. Because without meat, they cannot survive. All the time they eat more meat. In the morning, noon and evening they eat meat. That is to meet the energy requirement in extremes of cold. to generate the body heat. So, extremes of heat also, it will be under stress. To overcome the stress, high energy requirement is there. So these were the primary causes of inadequate intake of nutrients. Then there are secondary causes for inadequate nutrient intake. Secondary causes, it is highly lethargic. I cannot go to the food and eat. Another problem is inability to prehend. Inability to prehend because pain of the jaw, pain of chewing, pain on swallowing food, such as oropharyngeal disease. For example, there is a glossopharyngeal paralysis, mandibular paralysis, maxillary paralysis, maxillary fractures, painful conditions where you cannot chew well. There is temporomandibular joint dislocation, which is highly painful. It cannot grab. It cannot prehend the food. We are prehending the food with our hand and then eating with the hand. What about in the dog? They are not prehending with the hand. They are prehending with the jaw and then swallowing it. So a temporomandibular dislocation or luxation produces a secondary cause for inadequate nutrition. Severe periodontal diseases, teeth disease, painful teeth diseases, gingivitis, gingival ulcers, stomatitis, oral foreign bodies, neoplasia inside the oral cavity, temporal myositis. In all these conditions, act as secondary causes of inadequate nutrition intake. Then, if the animal is having nausea and vomiting, it cannot eat anything. Whatever it is gulping or swallowing, it is coming out due to vomiting. It is having a chronic gastritis. Some dogs are having Spirocerca lupi. Spirocerca is very common. See, the intermediate host of Spirocerca, the lizard is everywhere. Chronic vomiting, we have to check the vomitus also. We may be able to see the gelatin capsule, fine, small gelatin capsule shaped ovum, inside which the larva is embedded. Once it is found, yes, pakka, it is spirocercosis. Then, true vomiting is there, frequent vomiting. You check the kidney, check the creatinine. It could be 7.3 milligrams per deciliter. The phosphorus is 8.1. Oh, the phosphorus is high, the creatinine is high, the blood urea nitrogen is 493. Now you can say that it is chronic renal failure. It is CKD, chronic kidney disease. So, in such a condition, it can't eat anything, and the food eaten will not be retained, it will be vomited out. Sometimes regurgitation is nowadays very common. In my last class, in the vector-borne therapy class, vector-borne disease, I have mentioned that in each and every vector-borne disease, we should think that ticks are the main cause. Ticks are the main cause of vector-borne diseases. And so ticks, they inject certain neurotoxins. And these neurotoxins are highly responsible for paralysis of the smooth muscles as well as the skeletal muscles. Especially, if skeletal muscle paralysis occurs, we say it is a tick paralysis. If smooth muscle paralysis occurs, again, the visceral tubular organs will be affected, especially the skeletal muscles and the smooth muscles of the esophagus. There will be paralysis of the musculature of the esophagus. So the musculature of the esophagus dilates. Megaesophagus. So Megaesophagus is a true, a very, very, very common sequel of a vector-borne disease. Always keep in mind, this is true, and I have seen several times, especially in black Labradors. If a black Labrador is vomiting continuously, as the client says, he is vomiting continuously. Whenever he is eating the food, immediately vomiting out. So such a type of vomiting, it is not vomiting. It is regurgitation. So we have to ask the second thing. How is the vomitus? The vomitus is just like a cylinder. That's just like the tubular esophagus. That means it is a cast of esophagus. Esophageal cast. Like that it is vomiting out. It is a clear sign of regurgitation. So immediately we will ask the client, has it been under the medication, this international drug doxycycline? Yes, it was having a disease 2-3 months back. Then that is the reason. So that is regurgitation. So in regurgitation, we can advise certain feeding practices like raised feeding practice. If it is not there, nothing will be going inside. It will be retaining inside the loose bag like esophagus. And eventually it will be thrown out, that is regurgitated out. So nothing is going into the stomach, nothing is being digested, nothing is being assimilated, nothing is being absorbed. So weight loss occurs. Then esophagitis, the same thing. The classical sign is, it will come, smell the food and then run away in esophagitis. Sometimes there will be salivation, frothy salivation. It will drool like anything when it sees the food. Then esophageal obstruction. The same thing happens in esophageal obstruction also. It will be thrown out. But the throwing out will be more projectile in esophageal obstruction. And if the esophageal obstruction is in the cervical esophagus, we can even palpate. If it is in the mediastinal esophagus, of course, it needs either a gastroscopy or radiography. Then, in certain cases, there is anorexia associated with the diseases or drug therapy. If you give, there is pain on the animal, dog. I have seen that a clinical case came to me. It was a Dachshund, 10 kilogram weight. 10 kilogram weight Dachshund. And it had pain on the right forelimb. What treatment was given, you know? Acyclofenac paracetamol tablet was given to this dog. That too, one tablet TID in a 10 kilogram weighing Dachshund. And why it was presented to me? Because it was passing black tarry stools with the brown vomiting. Now you know what might have happened. So I suspect that all the GI tract, including the stomach, everything was ruptured. Because it was showing some tympanic sounds on percussion on the abdominal wall. As if there is gas collection inside the abdominal cavity. So, due to drug therapies, no inadvertent, injudicious drugs. Somebody may be going to a human doctor. He may be prescribing something. The same thing, he will come back, goes to his clinic, and he will prescribe this to the dog, which is brought into him. That is too shameful. We have our own pharmacopoeia. We have our own John's pharmacology. We have our Plum's reference book. All we have. So, due to some drug therapy, it will go anorectic. Another example is, judiciously we are giving, not injudiciously. Judiciously. A dog is presented with a pyometra. Or a dog is presented with pseudo-pregnancy. Suppose pseudo-pregnancy. What will you do? Quite natural, you will go for prolactin antagonist. One such pakka beautiful prolactin antagonist is cabergolin. Cabergolin is a very nice drug. Of course, it is very safe also. If you are using cabergolin, not more than 5 microgram per kg dose, it is absolutely safe. If it exceeds 5 microgram per kg, it produces severe gastric irritation. That too, if it is used in empty stomach, it will produce severe gastritis. That is pakka. But at the other side, cabergolin is another drug which directly stimulates the satiety center. Satiety center actually inhibits the appetite center. Both are found at the lower parts of the hypothalamus. This I described in the class of anorexia. Cabergolin directly stimulates the satiety center so that the animal will lose its appetite at all. When the satiety center is stimulated, it will stimulate the it will depress the appetite center. So cabergolin is such a drug. Then we have the third one. The first one was primary and secondary causes of inadequate intake of nutrients. Now we have increased nutrient requirement due to pathological factors. Nutrient requirement is more. The first is reduced nutrient assimilation. It is having good food, but it is not being properly assimilated in the body. Properly digested or assimilated in the body, absorbed in the body, such as maldigestion. The dog is having good food, but maldigestion is there due to exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. We know the pancreatic juice is very, very low in EPA. EPA is very commonly found. I have found EPA very commonly in German Shepherds and Irish Setters. EPA. How will you diagnose EPA in the field? It is so simple. Take an X-ray film. You cut a long strip from the black exposed portion, long strip. Okay, keep it there. The patient is there. Take 5 grams of stools. Okay, it is there. In a test tube, take 10 ml of 5% sodium bicarbonate solution. Mix it well, make a solution. 5% sodium bicarbonate solution. Into it, put some feces, 5 gram of feces. Mix it well. Make it into suspension. Okay, now you have made the alkalinized suspension of the feces. Into that, you introduce this black exposed portion of the, this is what I am doing very regularly. Black exposed portion of the film, X-ray film. Dip it inside. Keep it aside for 1 hour. After 1 hour, take it out. Take out the X-ray film. If the X-ray film has turned white or transparent, that means the dog is normal. The feces contains pancreatic trypsin. The feces contains pancreatic trypsin so that the pancreas is working normally. Otherwise, if the dog is having pancreatic insufficiency, there is no trypsin to decolorize this X-ray film. So the X-ray film will be dark only. Why the darkness comes? There is a gelatin covering, there is a gelatin layer over the X-ray film. This will be disintegrated by the trypsin in the feces. If trypsin is not there, gelatin will be there and the black color will be there. So if the black color is there, means it is positive for EPI, exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. Then bile salt deficiency. Of course, bile salts are produced from sodium salts of glycocholic acid and taurocholic acid. Sometimes there will be a deficiency, means there will not be. Why bile is there? Bile is there for emulsification of fat. First, the fat globules has to be split up into small globules. That is emulsification. Only after emulsification, lipases will come and act. So this emulsification cannot be done if bile salts are not there. Bile salts are surfactants also. They increase the surface tension of these globules, or they maintain the surface tension. Then, if there is a bacterial overgrowth inside the small intestine, this bacteria will act on the bile salts by degrading or disintegrating the bile salts, so that there will be absolute bile salt deficiency. That was something related with the maldigestion. Then malabsorption. Malabsorption syndrome. It is not so common. I have found one case in malabsorption syndrome. It is, the symptoms are just like in maldigestion, EPI. Whenever it is eating, immediately stools will be formed. Passing of stools will be very frequent. Malabsorption is due to inflammatory diseases or neoplastic infiltrates in the small intestine. Like in the case of intestinal lymphosarcoma, nothing will be absorbed. All the time it is passing stools, because the whole intestinal mucosa is infiltrated with neoplastic cells. This is not so common, but I have found one case. Whenever you are seeing lymphosarcoma, you should suspect that thing. Lymphosarcoma, I have found 8 cases. Then another cause of reduced nutrient assimilation is short bowel syndrome. The particular dog was having intussusception and complete necrotic intestine previously. What the doctor did, the doctor has to save the animal. He operated it well. When he looked, he found 1.5 feet completely necrotic intestines with intussusception. What generally we will do? We will cut the whole intestine like that, the necrotic, the dead intestine. What is the use of keeping it there? Enterectomy and enteroanastomosis. We will do it. But after that, what will happen? The consequence is there. The bowel is shortened. The absorption area is reduced. So that is known as a short bowel syndrome. So the nutrients will pass very easily without any assimilation, without any absorption, without any digestion. So that happens. And in turn will lead to weight loss. Then sometimes increased nutrient requirement due to pathological factors. In that, increased nutrient metabolism and or impaired synthesis of body proteins.
Hatfield Pharma introduces its herbal range, Hatpyrin Syrup. Natural and safe antipyretic, analgesic and anti-inflammatory. With the benefits of Guduchi, Sunthi, Vacha, Yashti Madhu and Musta herbs. antipyretic, analgesic, and anti-inflammatory syrup, Hadpyrin syrup. Indications: fever of multiple etiologies, post-surgical procedures pain management, painful condition like acute sports injuries, osteoarthritis and juvenile arthritis in pets, menstrual cramps in bitches. Dosage: for small breeds, 1 to 2 ml twice a day. For large breeds, 2 to 4 ml twice a day. For cats, 1 ml twice a day. Root: oral. Presentation: 60 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
These are the pathological factors such as hyperthyroidism. In hyperthyroidism, we know what will happen. The most active form of the thyroxine is T3, but the most stable form is the T4. And T3 will be converted to T4 and eventually needed for all the metabolic activities of the body. For intracellular metabolism, it is eventually needed. So in hyperthyroidism, what will happen? Increased thyroxine hormones, increased metabolic rate, increased burning of the nutrients or carbohydrates or whatever be the body tissues. In diabetes mellitus, since carbohydrate is not able to be metabolized, so from where the body has to gain energy? The nutrients has to be metabolized for need of energy. One second, please. The nutrients has to be metabolized. If carbohydrate cannot be metabolized, what can be done? Fat will be metabolized. Proteins will be metabolized. So in diabetes mellitus, there is more need of energy. Then in hypermetabolic states such as trauma, stress, systemic diseases, I have already mentioned in some two slides before. In all these conditions, the metabolic rate will be more to produce more energy. In trauma, it needs more energy for the building up of the traumatized or the building up of the shattered, the destroyed cells. It needs more energy. So, in stress, there will be requirement of more energy. I have mentioned it. I have explained it also. In systemic diseases, for the general body repairment and also for the immunity too. That is why it is said that when there is low or negative energy balance, the immune system will be shattered. Your immunity will be shattered. You will be less immune and you will be highly susceptible to any disease. So, pyrexia, in fevers, there will be more requirement of energy because there will be a hypermetabolic state and the nutritional factors, nutrients are being burnt off very fast. And so the need of energy is more. So increased nutrient requirement is there. It is due to a pathological factor. We have to find out what the cause of this pyrexia is. For every 1 degree rise in temperature, there is 13% rise in basal or resting energy requirement. every 1 degree rise, suppose the normal temperature, we know the normal temperature of human beings, 98.6. We know the normal temperature of horse, it is 100.6. Of the cow is 101.6. The dog is 101.5. The cat, all those we know. The fowl, it is 107 degree Fahrenheit. Suppose the dog is having 105 degree Fahrenheit temperature. And this particular animal is having a height hike of 3.5 degree Fahrenheit. So here it is told that for every 1 degree rise, there is 13% rise in resting energy requirement. So 3.5 degree Fahrenheit. So it is normally 36 degrees centigrade. So here the temperature is 38. Here it is 2 degrees centigrade rise, not Fahrenheit, it is degree centigrade. 2 degrees centigrade rise. So what will happen? 2 into 13, 26% rise in the resting energy requirement is there. The maintenance also doubled. So the increased nutrient requirement is there in fever. In neoplasia, such as when there is a cancer cachexia, the neoplastic cells are fast multiplying cells. They are in high need of energy. They need a tremendous energy. To meet this tremendous energy, if you are supplying more nutrients, nutritive or nutritious food, that is okay. Otherwise, normal food means it will undergo weight loss. Negative energy balance. In cardiac cachexia, the heart is insufficient. Heart is failing to pump the nutrified blood, whether it is oxygen or any other nutrients. It is failing to pump. It's a congestive heart failure. Failing to pump. So, energy requirement is more, but it is inadequate supplement. So what will happen? Thinning or weight loss occurs. In chronic liver diseases, there will be reduced production of albumins. See, we all know liver is the main seat of protein synthesis. Albumins and globulins. Globulins except gamma globulins. Gamma globulins are not synthesized from the liver. It is synthesized from the lymphocytes, not from the liver. Alpha and beta globulins are there. That is okay from the liver. But the gamma globulins, that is immunoglobulins, they are from the lymphocytes. Then in pheochromocytoma means it is a primary tumor of the adrenal gland. The adrenal cortex is neoplastic, and so there will be excess production of adrenaline and noradrenaline. So what will happen? The basal metabolic rate decreases. The burning of nutrients will be too fast, and so nutritional requirement is very high. What is it? Adrenaline is flight hormone. Then increased nutritional requirement due to pathological factors. Increased nutrient loss is there. Now in the previous slide we can see that increased nutrient metabolism is there. And so very quickly the nutrients are being metabolized. Here increased nutrient loss is there. That is second factor. In protein losing enteropathy such as lymphosarcoma, inflammatory bowel disease, then in inflammatory bowel disease, see PLE, what occurs in, see in cow there is jaundice disease. But due to chronic diarrhea there will be weight loss. Why emaciation happens in the cow? Due to constant protein loss. That is a protein losing enteropathy in parvoviral enteritis. In EPI, EPI of dog, exocrine pancreatic insufficiency of the dog. Why wasting or weight loss occurs? It is due to chronic loss of proteins through the stools, loose stools. That is a protein losing enteritis, enteropathy. Here both albumin and globulin are lost. Then proteins are lost through the urine. In glomerulonephropathies, the condition is known as PLN, protein losing nephropathy. In protein losing nephropathies, albumin is the mainly lost protein. Then chronic blood loss itself, blood is composed of these two proteins mainly, albumins and globulins. Plasma proteins are lost. In severe burns, nutrients are lost, that is plasma proteins are lost. Severe pyoderma, plasma proteins are lost. Purulent draining conditions, such as a pyothorax, plasma proteins are lost. Now we will come to know what are the consequences of weight loss. Once weight loss occurs, what will happen? As you said, it may be fatal. Why it becomes fatal? What are the consequences of weight loss? So in this topic we are going to study in sequence what are the events taking place in weight loss, progressive weight loss. I have already said that T3 is the more active thyroxine hormone, whereas it is unstable, but the T4 is the most stable one. The body will not keep T3 for a long time. The body generally kept it as unstable and it will be converted to T4 immediately. Why? Because if the T3 is there for a long time, metabolism quickly happens. The animal will undergo weight loss and emaciation or cachexia. So the first step as a consequence in weight loss is that the conversion of T4 to T3 will be stopped or reduced. Why? If T3 is there in adequate quantities, lot of nutrients will be burnt off. Fat and proteins will be burnt off. Let it not happen. Reduce the conversion of T4 to T3 so that the BMR can be lowered and there will be reduction in calorie requirement. So when there is reduced insulin secretion, hypoglycemia occurs. But when hypoglycemia occurs, quite natural, the glycogen storage in the liver and the muscles, especially there is heavy store of glycogen in the liver, they will be converted to glucose. And if that is not adequate, immediately other nutrients such as proteins or amino acids will be converted to glucose. That is gluconeogenesis. This will be stimulated by, or this will be undertaken by, corticosteroids which are released from the adrenal cortex. These are the step-by-step consequences occurring in weight loss. But when amino acids are burnt and fatty acids are burnt, especially fat and fatty acids are burnt, ketone bodies are produced. Of course, ketone bodies are produced. These ketone bodies will be converted to energy by burning it, by metabolizing it. To a certain extent, ketone bodies can be, that is what is happening in our body. Fatty acids, fat, etc. is burned out every time. And ketone bodies are formed, and this will be utilized for formation of energy, ATP molecules. But when excess fatty acid burning occurs, such as when there is a negative energy balance, when the carbohydrate cannot be utilized, in the case of diabetes mellitus, and excess fat is burnt, excess ketone bodies will be produced. We say if it is in a cow, it produces ketosis. If it is in a human being or a dog, it produces diabetic ketoacidosis, which is a very serious condition. We all know it. These everything are interrelated. DKA. So don't think that ketone bodies are very nasty things. No. They are actually utilized for our energy requirement. Everything in excess is not good. Ketone bodies are used as fuel. Still, if it is the energy, the intake requirement in the intake is less, still starvation or fasting is continued, then what will happen? All the glycogen resources, you see, when the glucose is being utilized, immediately glycogen will be utilized, split up into glucose. When all the glycogen is burnt off, total glycogen reserve will be completely exhausted. Then what happens? Immediately, for want of energy, the body will go to burn fat. Immediately they will catch the fat to burn. Fat will be used as a direct source of energy. So when fat is burnt, ketone bodies will be produced. Ketone bodies will be produced for energy requirement, for want of energy. If not much fat is available as an athletic man, body fat will be used, body protein will be used. From where the protein is being utilized, or from where the protein is being taken, that we will come to know. So here, when the fat is burnt, ketone bodies will be produced, and this will be used as a ready source of energy. That is good, okay. But certain cells, such as RBCs, nerve cells, fibroblasts, etc., they cannot metabolize ketone bodies for their energy requirement. They need glucose only. That is why the brain cells, they are unique. They metabolize glucose only through the pentose phosphate pathway. Like other somatic cells, utilize the glucose through the glycolytic pathway and the Krebs cycle. That is why this acetylcoenzyme A, TPP, etc. are needed in the brain a lot. This is the pathogenesis for PEM, polioencephalomalacia in the ruminant. Leave it. I am not going deep into all those things, because I know these metabolisms very well. That is why I am telling all these things. Leave it. In fact, RBCs, nerve cells, and fibroblasts, etc., they can utilize only glucose. So for their glucose, where this glucose is coming, already the glucose has been completely depleted, exhausted. The reserve was glycogen. It is also depleted. Now only fat and protein are there. But RBCs, neurocytes, and fibroblasts need glucose. That is a puzzling question. Immediately, what you know, what will do? What will be done? The brain will order the adrenal to produce more stress hormones, adrenocorticoids. The glucocorticoids will be produced. The glucocorticoids will convert this protein and fat to glucose. That is gluconeogenesis. And this glucose will be utilized by these cells. Then only it can survive. But by this time, you know what is happening. More fat and more protein is being burnt or converted into glucose. Gluconeogenesis is in a very, very dramatic position. So it will be depleted very fast. So what happens? Thinning in the animal occurs. Thinning, weight loss in the animal occurs. And protein, they are rich resources. They will be burnt only last. Slowly, slowly, each nutrient will be lost. First the carbohydrate, then the reserves such as glycogen, then the fatty acids, then the fat, then at last the proteins. So protein, when the protein stuff, where is the protein? Main protein is in our muscles. So what happens? Our muscle protein is lost. We'll become so lean. That is why during long stand starvation, we are becoming lean. This much of protein loss. So in animals with the diseases, not only in starvation, stress, injury or disease produces hypermetabolism. See, it is substantial. Not only starvation is there, but stress, injuries or any disease can produce a hypermetabolic pathway where more energy is being produced and stored in the ATP, eventually used for disease fighting or for the immune system or the injuries to repair or the stress to overcome. Okay, that is it. I think you are clear. Then I said gluconeogenesis, lipolysis, etc. All these things happen. So for fat, fat is being generally oxidized. For oxidization means giving molecules of oxygen. From where this oxygen is coming? From the inspired air. So there will be increased rate of respiration, increased depth of respiration that occurs. Okay, when ketone bodies are formed due to this fat metabolism, so if the animal is febrile, there will be 13% for each and every 1 degree centigrade rise in temperature, there will be increase in 13% resting energy requirement. So that we have seen. Then fibroblasts, they eventually need lot of glucose for their normal function. Lot of glucose. That is why it is said that for wound healing, fibroblasts are coming for wound healing. For any wound, extensively they are used for wound healing. So for wound healing, they are utilizing more amount of glucose. So they need more of glucose. And so the fibroblasts, they need more glucose for their action. And also the neoplastic cells. Neoplastic cells are hypermetabolic in action. Their metabolic rate is very high because they are fast multiplying cells, and inside that even the nucleic acid is also replicating. So they need more amount of energy. So these cells are in hypermetabolic states. They need more amount of energy. For that, lot of nutrients are being burnt. So what is the total outcome? What happens to the total outcome is the animal will have a negative energy balance. And when there is a negative energy balance, there is no source. If you are not loading with the nutritious food, if we are not loading with nutritious foods, it will undergo wasting, severe weight loss, because it cannot put on any weight. All the resources on the body are being utilized for energy. So what happens? At last, muscle protein will start burning. It is the last resort of the body. Muscle protein. It is very dangerous. See, muscle protein, the major portion is muscles, skeletal muscles. Our skeletal muscles are going to be burnt. So finally, the muscle protein starts burning. So we have proteins in the body. The first half, one half of the protein is stored in the body as muscles, blood and viscera. The muscle proteins inside the muscle, blood and viscera. And the second half is stored in the bones, ligaments, tendons and cartilages. Actually, they are known as the protein stores. All other, the muscle, blood and visceral proteins, they are always utilized. and they are always degenerated also. When we go to the gym and take 20 push-ups, our triceps muscle, our deltoides muscle, our trapezius muscle, everything will be degenerated. The muscle fibers will be degenerated. Immediately degenerated. But the stores will be kept as such. The stores are there in the bones, the ligaments, tendons and cartilages. This protein is not burnt until there is a marked weight loss. So, muscle protein depletion is obvious. There is no stored protein. When the muscle protein is depleted, we know the beautiful man will be having a very large triceps and biceps. But when he is not offered any food, he is being starved for weeks. Quite naturally, all his muscle will be burnt off. He will become so lean. Quite natural. So muscle protein is obvious. We can see it. Then, from the intestines, or intestine has lot of proteins. The intestinal wall. The intestinal wall becomes very thin.
Hatred Pharma introduces Heparaj Plus tablets. L-ornithine, L-aspartate 250 mg, thiamine mononitrate 1.5 mg, riboflavin 1.5 mg, pyridoxine hydrochloride 1.5 mg, nicotinamide 20 mg, calcium, D-pantothenate 5 mg, silymarin 100 mg and folic acid 1 mg. Multivitamin supplement with the power of silymarin. Heparaj Plus Tablets. Hepatoprotectant systemic drug. Indications: supplement to support healthy growth, general weakness and debility, geriatric support, chronic and acute liver disease, cirrhosis, hepatoprotective agent when hepatotoxic agents are ingested, example death cap mushrooms, beneficial in preventing certain cancers and improving the efficacy and reducing the negative effects of chemotherapy for certain tumors. Dosage: for small breeds, 1 tablet per day. Medium and large breeds, 1 tablet twice a day. Route: oral. Presentation: 1:10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatfit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
All the proteins of the intestine will be taken and burnt off. Finally, what happens for the maturation of the T cells, for the conversion of B cells into T cells, for the helper cells, for the immunity finally to develop? Definitely it needs lot of energy. But there is a negative energy balance, and so what will happen? The weight loss seriously affects the immunity. That is the ultimate outcome. The weight loss seriously will affect the immunity. And also, that is why it is said, after a surgery, we have to give lot of nutritious food. Because after a surgery, the wounds has to heal up. For the recovery and for the healing process, it needs lot of nutritious diet. Nutrients such as especially proteins and fat, mainly the proteins, for the absolute healing process. So when the animal is so lean and so thin and wasting, there will be complications post surgery. It is said that in human patients admitted to the ICU, 85% of the death will be contributed by this type of hypermetabolism due to insufficient nutrient calculation by the doctor or the nurse or whomever be. 85% of the ICU deaths. So also, if the patient is undergoing a chemotherapy against a neoplastic condition, and the patient is having a neoplastic, a tumor cancer cachexia, or the patient is having a no cachexia. See, two patients are there. both the patients are undergoing radiotherapy and chemotherapy against cancers. One patient is too much debilitated. He is too thin. He has wasted, debilitated. And other patient is very healthy and strong. He is not debilitated. Who has more survivability? Only the man who is not thin. The other one is having severe complications. He has a bad prognosis. I said he has a bad prognosis. If the animal has weight loss, the cause should be found out and the calorie and protein deficits has to be corrected at the earliest. Yes. No need for any explanation. So, we already seen how to calculate the energy requirement, the resting energy requirement, how to calculate it according to the body weight, the maintenance energy requirement, how to calculate according to the body weight. The maintenance energy requirement is to double the resting energy requirement in the dogs. In the cat, it is 1.4 times. So add these to the resting energy requirement and the maintenance energy requirement together, we can get the total energy requirement in a time of convalescence. Okay, that is what we are going to study. Then, what all things you have to investigate when there is a weight loss? Detailed history and physical examination will give a lot of clues. Of course, I always emphasize on clinical examination of the patient. You examine it clinically, you will get a lot of clues. On detailed clinical examination, you found a very large spleen. It is a debilitated animal, very large spleen. Of course, you can suspect a lymphosarcoma. You are performing ultrasound. You saw the granulomatous appearance, the heterogeneous appearance. Okay, you can clearly say it could be splenic lymphosarcoma. That is the reason for this cachexia. Then while you are taking history of this animal, age, breed and sex is very important. Young animals will have more metabolic energy. Old animals will be having less energy requirement. Breed, very active breeds and very silent breeds are there. Sharpies, very silent breeds. Saint Bernards, very silent breeds. German Shepherds, Labradors, Rottweilers, very violent and active breeds. Temperament is entirely different. So, we can assume the energy requirement from the breed itself. Sex, the males have more energy requirement than the females. Then the growing animals, pregnant animals has more energy requirement. Lactating animals has much more. Energy requirement is very high in the lactating animal. Then how is the temperament of your patient? Is it hyper-excitable? It is having more energy requirement. Nervous? It is having more energy requirement. It is lethargic always, depressed always. So, the energy requirement in such animals are comparatively less. Then the quality and amount of the diet which is fed by the client. Frequency of his feeding. See, according to the international feeding schedule, he has to feed the animal. The dog will become an adult one at 12 months of age. Up to 3 months, he has to feed at least 5 times a day. During the 4th, 5th and 6th months, he has to feed at least 4 times a day. During the 7th, 8th and 9th months, he has to feed at least 3 times a day. During the 10th, 11th and 12th months, he has to feed at least 2 times a day. Where at 12 months of age, the dog will become an adult. And beyond that, he need to feed only 1 times a day. That is the international feeding schedule that everybody knows. So, the quantity of feed, the amount of feed, the frequency of feeding is very important. And according to this, should be according to the degree of activity, age, and ambient temperature. What is this? What is the basic things? This we have to take during the anamnesis. Then the severity and progression of weight loss. Whether it is losing its weight very fast or very slow and progressive. Very fast means quickly, in 1 or 2 days means is severe dehydration. It is very easy. Go for fluid therapy alone. If it is so slow and progressive, that wasting is very dangerous. That is a nutritional imbalance, not a fluid imbalance. How is the appetite? Is it depressed or normal or polyphagia? Take the analysis. Is it having polydipsia and polyuria? Is it having vomiting or diarrhea? That means a protein losing enteropathy. Is it having exercise intolerance, like in the case of a cardiac cachexia? Is it having cough, like we are suspecting a cardiac disease, a congestive heart failure, or a left-sided heart failure? So, is it having cough? So, the current medications, of course, so many medications I have said, diclofenac sodium tablet, indomethacin tablet capsule, NSAIDs, all these drugs, NSAIDs can produce anorexia, cabergolin can produce anorexia, certain examples I have mentioned. Then the physical examination. How will you examine the patient physically? In most chronic infections, inflammatory or neoplasia, and some metabolic or endocrine problems show only some specific signs such as weight loss, anorexia and lethargy. See, physical examination is always a skill. This needs not only theoretical background, this needs practical experience also. Of course, you know. In malignancy, the weight is lost and the earliest clinical sign is the weight loss. Especially in GI, pancreas, liver, spleen, lymph nodes or bone marrow malignancies. The earliest sign in a malignancy in these organs is the weight loss. So physical examination here includes a careful and systemic palpation of abdomen and peripheral lymph nodes. What should be your initial diagnostic plan? Full routine hematological examination. Complete biochemistry profile including total plasma protein and AG ratio. Those things you know very well. Urine analysis, lateral and chest radiographs and abdomen radiographs. Fecal examination for helminthic ova. In cats, go for primary screening, lateral flow test of feline leukemia, feline immunodeficiency virus, feline AIDS, immunodeficiency virus, feline coronavirus, etc. All these we can go for primary screening through lateral flow. And we can go for other relevant tests based on history and the clinical findings. Now coming to the symptomatic treatment, these are all you know very well. Coming to the symptomatic treatment. But this is not fluid therapy alone. Correct the underlying cause. Correct the underlying cause. And if it is too much progressively wasting, the only way you can save the patient is enteral fluid, enteral feeding. What is enteral feeding? We have parenteral feeding. What is parenteral feeding? That is fluid therapy. That is entirely a different subject. Enteral feeding means through the oral route. He is not taking anything. But the food should go into the stomach. Then digest and assimilate according to its requirement. Now we have calculated the requirement. So our dog, which is having 20 kilograms, need 2010 kilocalories. 2010 kilocalories. That much of food has to be offered to the animal, this animal, our dog, for a day. So how will you feed it? You have procured some fat, you have procured some protein, you have procured some vitamins, minerals, all the vitamins, everything you have procured, and you mixed it up well. Okay, now each ml contains 1 kilocalorie. How will you feed it? If you give it orally, it won't drink sometimes. It is not a human being. If it is a human being, means you would have told him. You drink, you idiot fellow. You drink it. Then only otherwise he will die, you fellow. We can tell him. So naturally, he will drink because he has a fear of death. He will drink. But our patient is an animal. How can we deal with him? The only way is enteral feeding. You forcefully, you put a tube into the esophagus, into the stomach, and then you forcefully inject all this liquid food into the stomach. So if it is through the mouth, means the dog won't allow. But the dog will allow to put the nasogastric tube into the stomach. Not all the dogs. If you are going to put the nasogastric tube in a Rottweiler, which is 1.5 years male Rottweiler, that will be your last putting of nasogastric tube. You will not be allowed for any nasogastric tube application. So be very cautious while doing it. But this can be done in very docile dogs, especially Labradors, pups. In all pups, whatever be the breed, you can do it. Dachshunds also, you can do it. Especially in dolichocephalic dogs. It is much easy in dolichocephalic dogs. But it is not so easy in brachycephalic dogs. So, enteral feeding is indicated. This is a separate topic and it needs actually hours together. But I will tell the essence. Ensure that sufficient proteins and calories are reaching the animal's body to prevent catabolism. It should be highly palatable, highly nutritious food. So if it is consuming as such, okay, it is good. Offer it, it is eating and drinking well, okay, then you give it. If it is not drinking or eating it, then you have to force feed it. How? Not with the dredging gun. Esophagiostomy, gastrostomy, etc. should be done. That is what I am going to tell now. Vitamins and minerals are essential in dendritic therapy, especially in cats. In cats, when there is anorexia with the polyuria, there will be too much of negative energy balance. And so vitamins and minerals, vitamins especially, are essential for the cats. And in here, you can, if you are going for parenteral IV fluid only, it is dangerous and you will lose your patient. You go for enteral therapy. So total parenteral nutrition is nothing but IV fluid. That is parenteral. Parenteral means other than the enteral route. Parenteral nutrition is nothing but IV fluid therapy. And this is indicated only in acute conditions of the fluid loss, such as severe intractable vomiting or extensive GI tract disease like parvo. These are the conditions where you should undertake a fluid therapy. But an enteral therapy or enteral nutritional therapy should be undertaken in these type of wasting stages. Cachexia. So here, tube feeding is essential. So for tube feeding, you can use these type of prepared foods. These are all prepared foods of different companies. See these foods, Nutrient 1.5. This contains 1.5 kilocalories per ml. This contains 1 kilocalorie per ml. This contains 2 kilocalorie per ml. So it will be written on the, see this food, this is enteral food, enteral liquid food. This enteral liquid food, it is written. It contains 1 kilocalorie per ml. So if you are using this in our dog, which is 20 kilogram weight, which needs 2020 kilocalories per day, how much will you have to give? 2 liters. See, this contains one kilocalorie per ml. You have to give 2 liters of this food. So when you are using this food, another compounded food is there which contains 2 kilocalorie per ml, 3 kilocalorie per ml, it is there. We can choose according to our need. Sometimes it may be a very, very heavy dose of a dog having 40 kilograms. You need 4,000 kilocalories. Sometimes it could be a Chihuahua or a pug where you need only 700 kilocalories. For that you can use it. Okay. Now, see how we are introducing the nasogastric tube. So simple. Nasogastric tube it is being put, it is fixed there, and now an Elizabethan collar should be put, otherwise he may scratch it and take it off. Royal Canin has the recovery food. See, this contains, see this, 1 kilocalorie per ml. It is written. It is written, the enteric fluid. See here also, the 0.9 kilocalorie per ml, 1.3 kilocalorie per ml, everything is written here. See, this contains 1 calorie per ml. This is for very small pups, Pediasure. This is for all pediatric, very small pediatric with neonatals. For neonatals, it is 1 calorie per ml. Then it's only, well, 3 or 5 or 6 calories per day. Because the neonatal is always sleeping all the time. They need only resting energy requirement. For that, we need only this 1 calorie per ml. It is not kilocalorie per ml, 1 calorie per ml. So how will you put the nasal feeding tube? See, feeding tube, if you are not putting the nasal feeding tube, this is very simple, Dr. Sir. This is very simple. See, you sedate the patient. You put the, 18-inch artery forceps through the mouth, into the oropharynx, into the pharynx, and into the esophagus. Into the esophagus, you put it. And so you're putting it, and you just tilt it. You can feel the tip on the neck. Just make a small incision, and you can see this. You force the tip of the artery forceps through that slit. Then you catch that feeding tube. That is a number 8 pediatric feeding tube, or a number 10 or number 12 pediatric feeding tube. Catch it. Then pull it. Okay, you are pulling it. See, pulling it, and you are taking it to the out into through this hole. Now you fold it. I fold it, and the next tip, you push it to the esophagus. Push it, push it, push it, and at last you will. You can do like this. Now it is into the esophagus, going into the stomach. See, you can force any liquid diet into this feeding tube. Then you plaster it here, then you fix it here with sutures. With the sutures, you can suture it here, this hole, and then you can fix it here. You can put an Elizabethan collar to avoid scratching. All those things you can do. See, this is a cat where this esophageal tube is put. See, they have introduced it through, the tip of the artery forceps come here, pulled it. Then it is folding and it is being forced into the esophagus. It is not a very big thing. Otherwise, you cannot save the animal. Esophageal, that is the gastric feeding tube. Then we are going to the second topic, that is a weight gain. Weight gain is nothing but obesity. It results from excess intake of calories. Other causes include excess body water, large masses such as splenic tumor, and unsuspected pregnancy. So we are going to the next topic. So, obesity. Obesity, sometimes you may say that it is highly obese. Sometimes it may be a pregnancy inside, a fetus inside. Sometimes a splenic tumor inside. That we have to find it out. So, humans generally are obese. I have taught you when we should say where there is a weight loss. If the weight is having a lost 10% of body weight, then we can say it is weight loss. So when it is above normal, 10 to 20% above normal ideal body weight, it is said to be obese. In humans, it is height weight standards are there. I am 6 feet 1 inch tall. So my, take the term, height in centimeters. My height is 186 centimeters. 186, take the centimeters, take the height in centimeters minus 100. Mine is 186 centimeters. Minus 100 is 86. So 86 should be my ideal body weight. Unfortunately, I am 100 kilograms. My ideal weight should be 86 kgs. You can calculate here also. So that is the human height weight standard. If I am above 10 to 20% above the normal height, normal weight, then I am said to be obese. Obesity, 95% of the obesity is uncomplicated and only 5% is complicated. Let us see the uncomplicated obesity, the causes of the uncomplicated obesity.
Hatvit Pharma introduces its herbal range. Hatplat tablets, powerful tool to induce platelet formation. Carica papaya extract, Tenospora cordifolia extract, goat milk powder, wheatgrass extract, kiwi extract, pomegranate extract and vitamin E tablets, Hatplat tablets. Indications: lower platelet count, tick-borne viral infections and antioxidant. Dosage for dogs: body weight less than 10 kg, 1 tablet once a day. Body weight more than 10 kg, 1 tablet twice a day. Route: oral. Presentation: 1 into 10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatvit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
95% are uncomplicated and 5% are complicated. Let us see what are the causes of uncomplicated obesity. They are honor related. First, let us see the honor related causes. Failure to adjust the food according to the intake of the individual calorie needs. The owner fails to recognize that some dogs require less food than average. He is very affectionate to the dog and he is giving more food. And the dog, whatever he gets, he will swallow and he will get obese. And failure to recognize that some dogs require less food than average. Then failure to recognize needs with age, neutering, orthopedic and other diseases, reducing regular exercise. Failure to recognize needs with age, neutering, orthopedic and other diseases, reducing regular exercise. Sometimes he will be a very, very small pup. If you are giving lot of food, nutritious foods, he will be definitely producing obesity to his pet. And neutering, even a neutered animal, whether it is a orchidectomized animal has a male which has undertaken orchidectomy, or the female with spaying, complete spaying, oophorectomy, oophorohysterectomy. In such an animal, if he is giving more food, means all the food will be going for obesity only. Orthopedic conditions require more amount of energy. And he is giving, see, during an orthopedic condition with a fracture, etc., the animal is not at all exercising. He is inside the POP bandage. And in this condition, if he is feeding more, means it will become obese. And failure to take into account additional energies of energy obtained from snacks and supplements. He is giving it. See, these are all happening on daily basis. Simply giving snacks all the time, especially to the Dachshunds, Labradors, they will become obese. I have seen a Dachshund which was crawling like a python, such obese. If you take the cross section, it will be just like a big jackfruit, round one, with very small legs. The legs have gone into the fat. Only the feet or the fingers, the digits were seen out. You know, that much very, and there was a big callus on the ventral chest because it was crawling on the ground. It cannot walk due to severe obesity. It was only due to the overfeeding of the client. Then encouraging appetite. So feeding behavior as a sign of it. Encouraging, see, sometimes dog may be coming before the client and wagging the tail, and they may be biting the garments of the client. Give me, give me, give me. And always, oh, poor my pet, poor, let him give, let him be given. He is giving all the time food. When all the time food is being offered to the dog, definitely he will become obese. Also forcing the animal to eat more. When the animal is being dumped with a lot of food, and animal doesn't want food. He doesn't want food at all. He is not hungry. He doesn't want to eat. But the owner, this fool is standing there and always encouraging, eat, 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 eat. All the time. And what the animal thinks? Animal is very affectionate to the owner. When the owner is encouraging him to eat lot of food, he will eat and becomes too much obese. Then failure of exercise. Inadequate exercise due to lack of time of the owner. See, exercise means we cannot tell the animal, go exercise and come. We cannot tell that. We have to take them in a leash to go out. If the owner has no time to go out, then the animal also will suffer. Then cats. There are two types of cats according to our conditions. Our stray cats are there. Our ordinary mongrel cats. They are always out. They will come inside, they will eat, and they will immediately jump off. They will go out. They will roam around. They will fight. They will mate and come back in the evening with lot of wounds on the skin. These cats are very active. But what about our Persian cats? Persian cats are not, they are always gloomy and less active. They like to be always indoor. They never like to go outside. They never even drink milk also. They have certain peculiarities. They never drink milk. They don't like milk. But the other, you know, the mongrel cat, he drinks milk like anything. And he likes always roaming. But this fellow with lot of hairs, lot of fur, he will not like roaming. So he always kept indoor. Then finally the obesity of the owner. If the owner himself is obese, what will happen? Why he has become obese? He always eating snacks, always eating lot of food, especially proteinaceous, nutritious food. And always when he sees his pet, come on my dear, you also have this. He will offer his food all the time. When he is obese, naturally his dog also becomes obese. His cat also will become obese. That is quite natural. These are the owner related factors. Then the animal related factors are there. Factors other than the owner. Diet which is given to the dog or the cat. The homemade diets are there for this. Some people make homemade diets. In homemade diets, you know, they are very pure. They are highly nutritious. They will be rich in fat and protein. It is not like the hotel made. The hotel made are not nutritious, but it will be tasty. But the diet which is made in the home, it will be highly nutritious. The mother will make the food which is nutritious, rich in proteins, rich in fat, highly tasty. And there are no feeding guidelines for such food also. Ample amount of food will be given. All the food which is being offered to the dog or the cat will be eaten. And the animal has no activity, always indoor, no activity. Animal will become obese, quite natural. That is why the Shivakumar's dog was crawling on the ground like a python. He's dashed. Then high sugar diet. Mostly people ask us, doctor, will something happen if we give more sugar to our dog? See what happens. Some people ask that. So I have heard that if we give sugar, chocolate to the dog, the fur will fall. No fur falling. But what happens is that, see, all this excess sugar, as we do, the excess sugar will be converted to fat. And it will be stored in the body as reserve, energy reserves. Thereby they will put on weight, obesity occurs. That is what is happening in the dog also. See, if sucrose, our common sugar, sucrose is being offered. Sucrose, when it is split, hydrolyzed into two, they form fructose and glucose. Fructose is very, very efficiently used in the body and reserves are also formed. So sucrose is the main culprit. Sucrose is abundant in all the chocolates, all the bakery items. Sucrose. So they are efficiently used than glucose. Then high fat. Fat always increases the taste of the food. There will be very rich fat storage. When they are consumed, they will be stored as reserve in the body. and utilized. Actually, it is utilized. If it is having a condition like when glucose is being not utilized, like in the case of diabetes mellitus. So genetic factors are also there. See, even human beings, some has genetic factors like the familial factors. In this family, born children all are generally obese. Like that, breed factors are also there, genetic factors. Labradors, Cocker Spaniels, Dachshunds, Bassetons, Beagles, etc. are more prone to obesity than German Shepherds, Greyhounds, Yorkshire, Whippets, etc. All these are, see, Greyhounds, Whippets, etc. They are athletic dogs. They will never turn obese. That's a genetic factor. We know the Greyhounds. They are all athletic dogs. Their lean mass capacity, their back fat thickness, their lean mass, etc. are very low. They are all athletic dogs and very strong dogs which are having very good stamina also. Like as a Whippet also, they are all having good stamina. These are the dogs which are genetically absolutely not prone to obesity, like Great Dane, Greyhound, Saluki, the Italian Greyhound, the Avizan, then the Whippet, etc. All these breeds are genetically unprone dogs. Then social interaction with other animals. If more than one dogs are there, they'll be competing each other. Like what we see outside the stray dogs, they'll be competing. One man, one dog with the strongest, he will come and he will eat all the food, because if he leave any food, the other dog will come and eat. So he will grab all the food and eat all the food. So more than enough food he is consuming, and that is prone to obesity. That is a competition for the food. Then neutering. Neutering is another factor other than the owner. Before neutering, it had the gonads. The male had the testes, the female had the ovaries. During that time, it had lot of androgens also. The males had the testosterone, the females had the estrogen, and all these were being utilized. All the glucose, the fat, everything is being utilized by the powerful gonadal hormones for the bodily activities and the sexual activities and the growth. But now, after neutering, what happened? The testes is being cut away, the ovaries are being cut away, no gonads, no gonadal hormones, no such metabolism, and all the metabolism is utilized for other somatic purposes. And what will happen? The excess nutrient burning, the energy will be converted to ATP and fat, and this fat will be stored in the liver, which produces obesity. That is why neutered animals become obese. Then age. In growing stages, if you give more nutritious foods like high fat food, there will be hyperplasia of the adipose tissues, which in turn produces obesity. Once there is hyperplasia of the adipose tissue, it will never be gone. See, during the growth stages up to 6-7 months, it is a stage where you should not make your pup obese. During that time, if you are giving highly nutritious food injudiciously, the animal will undergo obesity. Then reduced metabolic rate and exercise with increasing age encourages obesity. When it is the age is at, when it was a very small age, the metabolic rate is high, and so the nutrients are very quickly metabolized. But when the age advances, the metabolic rate is low, exercise will be very low, and so obesity occurs. So 95% are uncomplicated obesity and 5% are complicated obesity. The causes for complicated obesity, we are mostly concerned with the complicated causes of obesity or the causes of complicated obesity, like the endocrine disorders. Hypothyroidism, yes. When there is hypothyroidism, in hypothyroidism, what will happen? There is no utilization of the nutrients. Thyroxine hormone is utilized for all the multiplication processes, all the metabolic processes. Not catabolics, all the metabolic processes, whereas all the nutrients will be metabolized and converted to energy. So when there is lack of thyroxine hormone, all will be deposited only. The fat, the protein, the water, everything will be deposited. There will be lowered protein metabolism, lowered fat metabolism, lowered water metabolism, lowered pigment metabolism, lowered mineral metabolism, everything will be lowered. So there will be obesity. Then hyperadrenocorticism. Of course, there'll be water retention. So it will add to the obesity. Then insulinoma, glucose cannot be metabolized. So, glucose will be metabolized more due to insulinoma, more amount of insulin will be produced. And so what happens? Glucose will be metabolized more. And so when glucose is being metabolized more, there will be a hypoglycemia. Due to that hypoglycemia, immediately there will be gluconeogenesis, excess glucose will be produced. All this excess glucose, when the excess glucose comes, insulin will not be sufficient. It undergoes the conversion of glucose into fat. So add to the obesity. Acromegaly. Acromegaly is, in turn it is, eventually it is high energy, high amount of growth hormone secretion. Growth hormone. So it in turn adds to the obesity. Hypogonadism adds to the obesity. Drug induced progestogens, for example, a progesterone, then medroxyprogesterone, etc. Those drugs which are previously used, nowadays it is not used, they will produce obesity. Then corticosteroids, we well known, they produce obesity. Diazepam is a very well known appetite stimulant. If, especially for the cat, as an appetite stimulant, if you give diazepam, it is excellent. Also for the dog and human beings also, it is an excellent appetite stimulant, diazepam. So when diazepam is administered for some anticonvulsant effects, it will increase the appetite, it will eat more and produce obesity. A long-term administration of diazepam in cats and dogs produces obesity. So also anticonvulsants like primidone also produces polyphagia. Primary hyperlipidemia, when there is too much of fat in the blood, hyperlipidemia, all the fat will be deposited in the body, producing obesity. Destruction of the satiety center of the tumor, no satiation, there is no depression of the anorexia, no anorexia at all, always it is eating more, polyphagia. So this is insulinoma, this is the duodenum, we can see the pancreas, this is the insulinoma, this is not easily diagnosed. See, in acromegaly, there will be increased amount of soft tissues on the gums, and so that you can see the growth and the protrusion of the incisors will be affected. It will be deferred and it will be not in a uniform line. It is across the chief symptom of acromegaly. And let us come to the consequences of obesity. If it is more obese, too much of fat will be there inside the larynx and the pharynx. So it will be snoring all the time, especially you can see in the Labrador, in an obese Labrador, in any obese dogs. That is why in obese people snore a lot, because of lot of fat and stenosis of the pharyngeal tracts. Athletes, they very rarely snore, because there is no fat inside the pharyngeal tracts. In human beings, so in dogs, there will be respiratory embarrassment. In human beings, more weight will be on the chest wall, and so there will be respiratory embarrassment in human beings. Osteoarthritis is very common in human beings due to the weight of the humans, because humans, they are standing erect. The whole weight will be coming on the stifle joint, and there will be osteoarthritis of stifle joint. But it is less common in dogs, but can be found in very heavy, obese dogs. I have seen it. They will be very reluctant to walk, and they will be lying on the ground all the time. Increased risk of infection, the infectious diseases. Definitely, the immune system itself will be suppressed, and there will be increased risk of infections. Diabetes mellitus in some dogs, these are the consequences. Fatty liver, this is a big complication, especially in the cat, if there is a fatty liver. It is generally said that if the cat is anorectic for more than 2 days, fatty infiltration or hepatic lipidosis develops, and thereby the cat may die after 5 days. So the cat should not be anorectic for more than 2 days. That is a general principle all over the world. That is idiopathic hepatic lipidosis in cats. Anesthetic risk. So we all know very well how risky is to anesthetize a very obese animal. Is it very risky? Cardiac arrest or respiratory arrest can happen at any time. And difficulty during abdominal surgery. See how you can imagine how difficult is an abdominal surgery in a dog with severe obesity. When you open up the abdominal cavity for a cesarean section or oophorectomy, you can see it is completely covered with fat. Too much of mesenteric fat. You cannot sometimes, very difficult to identify the organs. Another thing is complicated clinical examination. It will complicate clinical examination. You see, very big surface, very large body. Along that, you are auscultating it. It hinders auscultation because of the large size of the body. Then too much of abdominal fat, you cannot palpate and find out splenomegaly or hepatomegaly. If it is a lean dog, like in the case of a greyhound or a whippet or a great dane, you can palpate it very easily. But in a very fluffy, fatty Labrador, it will be very difficult. You know it very well. Chance of FLAGD, the feline urinary, lower urinary tract infection, it is very common. And precipitation of the feline urine is also very common in obese cats, more than in normal cats. Chance of pancreatitis is much more in dogs and cats than poor respiratory reproductive performances. An obese animal, Labrador, which might have been a breeding animal, which will not mount, it cannot mount due to the overweight. It cannot mount, it will not mount. So poor reproductive performances. How will you take the history, the checklist, age, breed, sex? Is it young or old, neutered, breed predisposed to obesity, all those we have mentioned. Lifestyle is exercise, but dog with an exercise or indoor cat. If it is a dog with more exercise, means it is a naturally athletic dog. Indoor cat means more prone to obesity. Type of diet, if homemade diet is being fed, definitely there is chance of obesity. Tidbits all the time, snacks, everything, all the time, definitely it occurs. Begging behavior, oh, the animal will be coming for the owner, begging, give me, he will be scratching the body. Then immediately he will give all the snacks. He will eat that. The greedy Labrador will eat everything. Any other pets, if there is a competing pet inside, he will come and grab all the food without giving the food to the other dog. So is there a competition? Appetite is normal. Polydipsia, polyuria is there? No. If it is having Cushing syndrome, it will be having. Definitely, it will be putting on weight. Polyuria, polydipsia, the excess is intolerance, collapse, etc. Nothing is there. Then lameness is there. Okay, it could be due to the obesity. Current medications such as diazepam, steroids, progestagens, anticonvulsants like primidone. When we are giving all these drugs, definitely there is a chance of obesity. Then physical examination, abdominal palpation for pregnancy, spleen, liver for Cushing syndrome. Palpate for pregnancy. Sometimes overweight is due to pregnancy, which you cannot understand. You don't have an ultrasound machine. Then your method of examination is the abdominal palpation. Then the spleen for palpation of to find out the splenomegaly, liver for the liver is enlarged, we can say that to a certain extent it is Cushing syndrome. Changes on the skin for endocrine disorders, for example hypothyroidism, remember our dermatology classes, go for hypothyroidism, go for Cushing syndrome, because your dermatological disorders, ascites, pericardial effusions and other edema, etc. can be well, it can be monitored, and it can be diagnosed from the clinical science by physical examination. Ascites increases the body weight. Complete possible systematic examination should be done. Radiograph if needed can be taken. Ultrasound if you have it, you can do it. Then very better is rib palpation. Palpate the rib or go through one rib. Palpate the rib. And there is soft tissues over the rib. You palpate the rib and see how far you can touch and palpate the rib. If you are able to palpate the rib, okay, it is normal. If only ribs are seen, not rib and thin skin is seen, it is highly skinny dog. It's too emaciated. But if it's put on weight, means the thickness is 0.5 or above centimeters thickness of soft tissue over the rib. Okay, it is pressing, but you can feel the rib. In that case, you can see that it is moderately obese. And if it is more obese, you may not be able to palpate the ribs. Only the soft tissues, skin and subcutaneous fat and soft tissues over the ribs. That is very important. That needs certain skills also. So for initial diagnostic plan. A full routine hematological and biochemical examination, full profiles, and lipid profile also should be done. So all these things we know very well. Urinalysis for urine sugar, urine ketones, etc. for secondary diabetes mellitus. ACT stimulation test for Cushing syndrome, thyroid function evaluation. All these tests may not be needed if a clinical examination details are conclusive to give sufficient clues. Natural. How will you manage obesity? That is very important. Identification of, first of all, you identify the animal is obese and assess the obesity. Then go for clinical examination for the causes. Then do the client counseling for managemental issues. See, don't feed, advise the client, don't feed this much. Why you are going near the animal and you encouraging it to eat more and more? Don't encourage it so. Why you are giving snacks all the time? See, it is already 3 years old. It is internationally standard is that you should feed your dog only one time a day. Now what you are doing, you are feeding it 5 times a day. You are the culprit. You are making it obese. No, it should not be done. You should advise. So also, it is a Labrador. It is prone to obesity. It is a Cocker Spaniel. It is prone to obesity. It is a Dachshund. It is prone to obesity. So such things, you have to advise the client. So client counseling is very important. Assessment of the target weight. So take the total weight. Now, suppose it is a Dachshund. It is 25 kilograms. Definitely it is overweight. It should be naturally 10 to 12 to 13 kilograms. Now it is 25 kilograms. It is obese. So our target weight should be 12 to 15% less than the present weight. That means below 25, our target weight should be fixed below 12 to 15%. That is coming around 16, 17 kilograms. So suppose it is 17 kilograms. Fix it at a low level, 12-15% reduced low level. That should be the target weight. It should be achieved in 2 months or 3 months. Or 13% in the cats. Let us say 25 kilogram body weight, obese Dachshund. We are keeping the target in 17 kilograms. Then select the type. See, also keep target is 17 kilograms. Select the type and quantity of the diet. Calculate the BER and MER. The MER, set the type and quantity of the diet. 40 to 60% of the MER at target weight in dogs and 60% in cats. So calculate the MER in the target weight. The target weight is 17 kilograms. So the MER, that is 70 plus 30 into W, that is 70 plus 30 into 40. The body weight is 25. 70 plus 30 into 25. That much of calorie is the MER. Take only 40 to 60% of the calculated MER. That should be the target MER. Then select the food according to the target MER. Select the food according to this target MER. It's very easy. So also 60% in cats. I will give you this PowerPoint so that you can, it is very easy, you know, it is very easy. Then regular re-examination, regular re-evaluation. Selection and quantity of maintenance diet when target weight is achieved. Okay, but generally by 2 or 3 months, you will, if you are well, if you are confident enough, you can attain the target body weight. Regular follow-up is necessary. Then certain drugs can be used, such as thyroid hormones. Thyroid hormones can be used. In human beings, they are generally being used. Growth hormones, beta-adrenergic receptors, beta-adrenergic agonists, such as epinephrine, norepinephrine, etc. is not being used. Alpha-adrenergic agonists, such as prazosin, etc. This is not generally used. But just keep in mind that these are all taken from textbooks, Talwart's textbooks. Then anorectic drugs, drugs which induce anorexia, such as fenfluramine, which is generally used in human beings. Overeating human beings, it is used. Fenfluramine. So these are the things. Bharat Mata Ki Jai!